when we're thinking about origins of life, and I also think a lot about alien life, is we need to generalize beyond life as we know it, I think, to understand a lot of the properties of life as an abstract feature of our universe in the sense that we talk about in theoretical physics. So if you think about the sort of paradigm of theoretical physics, like the paradigmatic framework of what is theoretical physics about, it's about building abstractions that unify as many parts of reality as possible under a similar conceptual framing, right? So motion is a good example. You know, I could look at all moving objects and I don't care about their color. I don't care about their shape. I care about their mass and their velocity. Right. So what abstractions matter for talking about unifying motion is mass and velocity. And those are inventions of our theories that correspond with measuring devices. What I'm saying here is when we're talking about evolved objects, the abstractions that matter are this kind of depth in time and also its relation to other objects. But I'll talk specifically about concrete observables in a minute. But the reason for doing this is because we don't think necessarily, at least in this day and age, and I hope is the topic of this conference, that the only minds that exist are biological minds, right? I'm not sure that I'm convinced any AI right now is a mind, but other people might be. But we do care about technological minds and we care about alien minds, right? What is the space of possible minds our universe can construct? I think this is a really relevant question and an interesting question for reframing some of the ways that we talk about the nature of mind. And obviously, that's an important, you know, very pressing conversation that people are having now. So when we think about where we exist in the space of possibilities and how we interact with the world and that other things have co-evolved with us on the same planet, there's a whole bunch of trajectories through this space that we don't know. And those are, you know, maybe technological minds that might be evolved from our same chain of event, our same causal chain constructed over time, or they might be alien minds that have completely different histories than we do. So I've been putting on this axis here assembly time because I'm not really actually thinking about this as clock time. I think about time in a different way than standard conceptions of physics. It's much more like a causal time. And it's always interesting to me to look back at the history of physics trying to invent new physics because you see that like every theory of physics invents its own concept of time. So why not? actually, it's interesting because every century invents a concept of time, and they're really strongly correlated with the cultural narratives of that period in time and technological inventions. Yeah, I'm actually more thinking about like clockwork universe and like Newtonian time is invented based on clocks, right? So what is causal time? I think it's because we live in a very complex world and we're realizing time is not exactly linear. It's combinatorial, which is fun. Okay, so I mentioned at the beginning this assembly theory. So assembly theory is a theory that is structured to solve the problem of the origin of life, which I'll talk a little bit how we're thinking about that in a minute. But the way that is like sort of the base of assembly theory is to say that there are objects you observe, right? Those objects we observe are physical things that exist like you and me. And you can deconstruct those objects to their basic building blocks. So let's not talk about you and me because it's too complicated, but let's talk about a molecule. A molecule is made out of bonds, right? So people think it's made out of atoms, but if you're actually talking about constructing a molecule is made out of bonds. So bonds are the physical thing that build molecules. Molecules made out of bonds. So if I take a molecule apart and I look at its bonds, there's a whole space of molecules I could build, that combinatorial space of chemistry I was talking about, and it's exponentially large. And in fact, if I had no physical constraints, that space is super exponentially growing with every new operation I do in that space. So that space is huge. That space is actually non-physical because I haven't imposed any of the laws of physics or operations we know that can happen in our real universe. So we might want to add some constraints and say we only want to do possible operations. We only want to make bonds that actually can form. So Lego is maybe even better. So some of you are not chemists. I see people scratching their heads, like thinking about how would you construct a human and how would you construct a molecule? How many people have played with Lego? Lego. Okay, we know Lego. Okay. You know how they have little you know, pieces on them? So, you know, like the, what are the knobs called? I don't know. Studs. Let's just call them studs. Okay, so they have little studs on them, right? So assembly, the space of possible Lego structures, if there were no physics involved, no constraints imposed by how they have to fit together, let's say you have super glue, is like a really huge space, right? You can make all kinds of weird stuff out of Lego. And every time you add a new piece, the number of possibilities grows. if I am constraining myself to actually using those little studs to piece things together, I've constrained the space of possible objects to be ones that are physically consistent with the rules of the Lego universe. And then the next sort of constraint you might want to add is that you can't spontaneously assemble things for free. You have to build them out of things you built already. And this is what we call assembly clause or assembly contingent. This is an old label, so it's actually called assembly contingent in the paper, but that's this one. So you've added more constraints. And this is the feature that objects are built along historically contingent trajectories, which means if I want to build a Lego castle, I build a part of it first, and then I add that part to another part, and then I add that part to another part. And so this actually constrains the sort of trajectories through what objects get built, because once you start constraining and building things, you can only build out of what you built before. And so this means that the sort of trajectories for building objects are historically contingent. So what we see when we take objects that exist and we deconstruct them is a particular example of a contingent history, but it tells us something about the space of histories that could have been, that sort of space around it of what evolution could have done but didn't. And so assembly theory doesn't have initial conditions. It doesn't have laws of motion. It has objects and their causal histories, and then constraining the future based on the causation that you find in objects in the present. Now, this gets at some interesting things, because what you talk about as fundamental in this theory is not what we talk about as fundamental in current theories of physics. And one of the reasons for that, I think, is really important, because, again, looking at the history of science, we have invented a lot of technology in the short history of science. And every time we invent new technologies, what we call fundamental changes. A good example is atoms, right? So atoms are the things in the periodic table, and they're called atoms because we thought they were indivisible, like the Greek atom. And then we realized they had substructure. And now sort of the most fundamental theories that people want to propose are things like string theory, which is even more fundamental, but currently inaccessible to our technology. We want to define fundamental as the smallest objects in the universe. The problem is, when you're an observer existing in the universe, what you call fundamental changes with your evolutionary history, how much technology you've evolved, how much you can measure. And so a theory of evolution that tells you about where you are in an evolutionary chain cannot have a fixed, finite object as an indivisible object as your fundamental particle. It can't be the fundamental structure of your theory. So assembly theory is a theory of objects. It's kind of funny because I got through a whole physics education without knowing what an object was. And then I started to think about it. And so we define objects as having several features. One is that they're finite and distinguishable. So you see a basketball and a soccer ball in the universe. You don't see a smear of every possible kind of configuration of ball in between. They're finite, distinguishable objects. Objects are breakable. I could decompose your brain into atoms. I can decompose a molecule into atoms. I cannot decompose an electron into anything. It is not an object. It's a limit of your observations. Objects exist more than once. This is a weird feature and probably one of the most unintuitive things, but one of the key features of assembly theory is this idea of copy number, that things that are created by evolution can be produced again, and that the copies of objects matter. So we are not identical objects as humans. So you say, like, I'm not an object in the theory, I don't exist. But actually, if you look at us and you look at our causal history, and you look at where we exist in the space of possible, we're nearly identical. You know, we're 1% of our genome is different, right? So you can follow these causal trees building up these objects all the way to the branches, and we're the kind of the things that are alive now are just the branches of these trees. Objects are lineages. So this gets to the point about objects existing in time, right? So in order to get to something like you or I, we think, you know, about 4 billion years of evolution has to happen on a planet. And my friend Michael Lockman is really great about saying, when you ask him how old he is, that he's 3.8 billion years old, because some of the information in his body is that old. And even in your lifetime, you're not the same atoms you were when you were born. So what is you? You are the lineage. You are the thing that keeps getting reconstructed. Objects form via selection. I love this website. Sometimes I put it on my slides that just will generate a human. It's one of, you know, one of the neural networks that's just fun on the internet. But, you know, like the whole idea is this person does not exist, right? So the space of things that cannot exist is really big. And so you have to ask, well, like, why are we the ones that exist? why are chairs the things that exist that we sit on, right? Because they were selected out of that possibility space to be finite, distinguishable physical objects. Selection is the mechanism that does that. So this depiction here is an assembly space. It is an assembly space for adenosine, which is a molecule that is used in DNA. And I mentioned that molecules are built out of bonds. So the way we do it is to build the assembly space is you do a joining operation between two elementary building blocks. You build something else. Once that thing is built in the assembly space, you can use it again to build something else and again, and combine it with other features that exist in the causal pathways to build up the object. But when I talk about assembly theory being a theory of objects, this is what we would usually call the object. But in assembly theory, the object is this pathway. It is an informational object extended in time. So adenosine is this pathway. It has all of those features as sort of the compression of this object as a physical object as it is constructed across time. Okay. So I mentioned, thinking about theories of motion, we talk about very specific variables that appear in our abstract theories to describe those objects. And then we give those variables physicality. We talk about these being the real physical features of objects. The things that we assign as physical features of objects are features of our theories, not necessarily the objects. They're features of our descriptions. They have to have a correspondence with the real properties of the objects. Otherwise, we're not doing physics. But in assembly theory, we care a lot about being able to go in the MATLAB and measure things because we actually want to do the experiment to solve the origin of life in the lab using digital chemistry to explore chemical space. And we need to be able to measure when life evolved from a chemical soup in the lab.
If you enjoyed this Toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toe Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toe community. You'll also receive my top 10 toes. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.